Welcome to worship. We're so glad you gathered with us today and hope you're getting used to these online worship sessions. I know we talked a little last week about this week being different than our first couple in quarantine, and I hope things are going well with you. I still have my gloves and my mask and my wipies. We're trying to continue to do all we can to keep ourselves safe and others around us. I hope that is what you are doing as well. I want to remind you that on the side of the screen, there are three links. One for the e-news. You can click on that link if you haven't yet to sign up for the e-news and get all of the things that are continuing to go on through and around Park City Community Church. There is a prayer button, one way we can all stay connected during this really difficult time of distance is to continue to pray for each other and ask for prayers. There's also a give button, and that, as I've mentioned before, is difficult for some at this point. We totally understand that, but are also so thankful for those of you who have continued to give as you are able. So on this Mother's Day, and happy Mother's Day to all of you mothers, all of you grandmothers, aunts, and inspiring women who have used your guidance and love to mentor others, we thank you. Happy Mother's Day and enjoy worship.
Hi everyone, and thanks for joining us for this Sunday's worship. Before you join me in our opening prayer, I just want to wish a very happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there and say thank you for all you guys are doing during this time of quarantine. And thank you for all your guys' endless love for your family, your endless compassion. I don't know, maybe your endless patience, but definitely for the endless meals that you've been cooking for your family, for your kids, during this time while they're all stuck at home. I've thrown together a video for you guys. You stick with us until the end of this video, you'll get to see that. But first, I wanted to wish a very happy Mother's Day to my mom. Happy Mother's Day, Mom. And to my aunt, my godmother Janine, to my auntie Jennifer. Happy Mother's Day, guys. And missing and wishing my grandmother was here. It's our first Mother's Day without her. We miss you, Mama. But yeah, I just wanted to share with you guys how significant a role women have played in my life from the very beginning up until even now. As I work alongside Tracy and Natalie, Kristen, Nina, Jennifer, you guys continue to influence me and show examples of what love is, of kindness, of faith. I don't know why, but God is the Father. But he's chosen to translate his love to me through women. And the way I see his light shine in my life is through the mother, mostly. My father loves me, I love my father, but I'm just saying throughout my life, the dominant theme has been women and the mothers, and it continues to be, and I don't expect that to change anytime soon. So thank you guys for always being there, for showing me what it is to be faithful, to be loving, to be caring, to be kind. Without you, I don't know, what kind of man I would be today. So thank you. Now I invite you guys to join me in our opening prayer as the words appear on your screen. Dear God, we are grateful today for connections, relationships, for love. We are grateful for those who loved us into existence, nurtured and cared for us. We're grateful for ongoing relationships of support and encouragement. And oh God, we are grateful for your creative love that is behind it all. As we worship together, remind us again of your fatherly and motherly presence in our lives. Amen. Thanks for joining us again, guys. Enjoy the service.
Thank you. got this feeling inside my bones. It goes electric, wavy when I turn it on. All through my city, all through my home. We're flying up, no ceiling when we in our zone. I got that sunshine in my pocket. Got that good soul in my feet. I feel that hot blood in my body when it drops. Ooh, I can't take my eyes off of it. Moving so phenomenally. Come on, like the way we rock it. So don't stop. I got that sunshine in my pocket. Got that good soul in my feet. I feel that hot blood in my body when it drops. Ooh, I can't take my eyes off of it. Moving so phenomenally. You're more like the way we rock it. So don't stop that.
I invite you all to join me now for our time of prayer and meditation. Dearest God, like a mother, you gather your people to you. You are gentle with us as a mother with her children. Despair turns to hope through your sweet goodness. Through your gentleness, we find comfort in fear. Thank you, God, for the love of our mothers and all the mother figures in our lives. Thank you for their care and concern. Thank you for the joys they have shared with us and the pains they have borne for us. Thank you for all they give us. On this Mother's Day weekend, we give thanks for all who have mothered us in our lives. We also recognize, however, that the relationships with our mothers and mother figures, like all of our relationships in life, are complex. Therefore, we pray for those who have not had positive relationships with mothers, and all who have lost them too soon. We pray for those who never knew their mothers, for those whose relationships were strained or difficult, and those who longed for more. We pray for those with mothers who are sick or away. We pray especially for those who wish but cannot be present with their families at this time. We also pray for the mothers and mother figures in our lives, for those who have lost a child, for those who labor long hours and sleepless nights, for those trying to make a better life for their children each and every day. We pray especially at this time for mothers and mother figures in our lives who are home with children, helping with homework, trying to balance work and play, and feeling exhausted during these difficult days. I invite you now to lift up your own prayers or thanksgivings, silently or aloud. Hear us, Lord, in all of these prayers and thanksgivings. Let us close with the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
So we've now reached the point of worship where we reflect upon our ability to give. It is during this music that we allow you to reflect upon your ability to do so. If you are able, we are so grateful. It enables the ministries we support to continue. It enables us to continue supporting our community partners as they are so taxed at this time, as they continue to do their work and help those struggling most in our community. We realize that it is a very difficult time for many right now, and that is okay. You give as you can through your time, your volunteerism, your prayers, and we are equally as thankful for that. So during this time, while we pray and listen to the music, you can hit that give button, and that is your opportunity to share as you are able. So right now we'll bow our heads, say a quick prayer, and listen to the music and reflect. Dear Lord, today, this Mother's Day, we pray for all mothers and those who long to be mothers. We pray for the mothers who have lost a child. Heal her heart, bring her peace. We pray for mothers who have children serving in the military. We thank her for her courage. We pray for the mothers who have children far from home. Remind her she is never alone. We pray for the single mothers. Fill her with your strength, love, and guidance. We pray for the woman who did not bear her own children. May she always know her love, mentoring, and guidance of all around has not gone unnoticed. We pray today for all of the women who have nurtured, prayed, and loved each and every one of us for all of our days. Amen.
People weathered the flood. Mothers brought life again on the wings of a dove. And Moses set the Lord's people free, thanks to a mother's love and a basket of reeds. Mary, the Mother of God, sanctified motherhood, glorified love. There was no fear when he came to her womb, or when Mary Magdalene came and wept at his tomb. And Jesus told us in his last hour, behold your mother, behold his power. She wiped my tears and dried my eyes, Held me close, sang me lullabies. You bring us life, you bring us joy. A beautiful girl, a precious boy. Man was made in the image of God, but mothers were made of peace and love. Mothers must come from heaven above. Christ still healed the sick and the lame, as Mother Teresa did it all in His name. And the motherland of Germany, her walls came crashing down, all the people are free. They say we won the mother of wars, but the winners are the mothers who teach their sons from fighting more. Mother Lode brought us here today, searching for riches lost, a new life, a new way. But now Mother Earth, she must be repaid. Return the beauty torn by the shovel and spade. Let us not forget, as we worship and pray, on this peaceful morn, all the beautiful days, when she wiped my tears and dried my eyes, held me close, sang me lullabies. You bring us life, you bring us joy, a beautiful girl, a precious boy. Man was made in the image of God, but mothers were made of kisses, hugs, and peace and love. Mothers must come from heaven above. Mothers must come from heaven above. I know that mothers come from heaven
Day.
Hi everyone, it's Nathan, Pastor Tracy's son, and on this Mother's Day, my mom asked me to read the scripture for today, and that's pretty hard to say no on Mother's Day. Today's reading is actually a short one from John's Gospel. It describes a story where Jesus is on the cross, and with him are his mother and his close friend. And Jesus is now entrusting these two people to care for each other. It's his way of extending care and community amongst his people. It's certainly something, that kind of care that I've received from moms out there, and I just want to wish everyone a happy Mother's Day. So here's the passage. Standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister and Mary Magdalene. And when Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son." And to the best friend, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his own and accepted her as his mother. Thank you.
Good morning and a happy Mother's Day to all of you moms and you mother figures and all of you great women who have done such an amazing job of inspiring all of us out there. Thank you. As a minister and as someone who has lost both a mother and a child, I know that Mother's Day can be filled with a variety of feelings, and that all of you have some different experiences with your moms and families. So I've been checking in during this COVID quarantine to check in with different church families. And so I've been hearing from some of you about how much you love and you value your families, and yet also truly how complicated and messy families can be at times. And so I've been listening to you this week particularly, and I have heard that, you know, especially around Mother's Day, it can be an especially difficult time and especially difficult day for many of you. I know that some of you may be experiencing a broken heart right now over a strained relationship with a child. Some of you may be experiencing a strained relationship with a mother. Some of you are mourning the loss of your mother. Some of you may be mourning the loss of the person you used to recognize as your mother, who now, late in their life, that person doesn't even look like the mother you remember growing up with all those years. Some of you may be grieving the loss of a child, the death of the one that you brought into this world. Others of you may be grieving the loss of a child to drugs or addictions. And others of you may be grieving the hope of ever being able to have children. And so I know that with all that, Mother's Day can be filled with, for some of us, with really warm memories and gratitudes of a loving mother, or the blessings of getting to be a parent. That's such a great feeling. And for others, it's a day that also carries with it some pain and resentment that goes with the depth of family relationships. But my guess is that most of us live somewhere in that mix, especially this year, as I've been talking with people. And, you know, most people are reporting right now that they are feeling the stresses and strains of family life, given especially the challenges of quarantine. And honestly, I don't think that God intended for even the healthiest, most put together, functioning family to be together 24 hours a day, 7 days a week for months at a time. I don't think that was ever part of God's plan. And then when you add to that parents who are both trying to work at home or trying to run a business out of the home while also trying to supervise online learning, or while working the front lines trying to provide for their families, or in the medical profession trying to keep the rest of us safe, and then coming home and having to deal with families at home. And then for our adolescents, there's that social distancing and isolation that's taken its toll on them, especially adolescents who thrive on peer interaction. And then without that regular part of their social balance, you know, it's taken a toll, and we've seen that rise of anxiety and depression. You know, if you take away kids' regular social activities and you keep them sequestered at home with their families, and then you try to find ways to motivate them, to keep them engaged with distance learning, there's a lot to balance for everyone in the family. And then a lot of moms and families are talking about the pressures of trying to keep connected with their older parents and wanting to be able to check on them, but for health reasons, feel like that might be a greater risk at this point. So the moms I've talked to this week, from brand new moms to the more experienced older moms, you know, most of them sound a bit tired, a bit worn out, a bit stressed and strained and pulled in a lot of different directions. So I talked to them about, what is it then that you really want in your relationships with your children and your families right now? And so I compared their responses to some of the top answers I found online. So here's what moms of little kids wanted. And I'll go from the top five. Here's what moms of little kids wanted right now. Number five, to go to the bathroom by myself, right? If you've ever been a mom of little kids, you know that the greatest and sometimes the only place you get that privacy is just to lock yourself in the bathroom by yourself. I shared that with somebody in one of my spiritual reflection groups this week, and she said, yeah, when I was a mom with little kids, she goes, I went in the bathroom one time, tried to get in the bathtub just to get a moment away from my own kids. And she said, I was in the bathtub, and she said, sitting in the bathtub, and some little neighborhood girl came in while I was in there and sat down next to me and put her foot up on the bathtub next to me and said, Miss Stukin, can you just tie my shoe for me? She goes, even when I'm in the bathtub, the neighborhood kids are coming in and finding me. So number five, just to be able to go to the bathroom by myself. Number four, here's what moms are looking for. Sleep, sleep, and more sleep. Number three, less arguing and fighting. I had one mom say, I just long for one day when I don't have to wear the referee shirt for the day, when I don't have to be the arbitrator amongst arguments. Number two, if kids could just learn to clean up after themselves, just for a day, that'd be great. Number one, hugs and kisses and lots of I love yous, right? Every mom wants that from their kids. And then this year we added a 1A. Because of the year of quarantine, we thought maybe we should add one extra line item this year. And that would be freedom. Time alone. That's what moms want. Usually for Mother's Day around this time, moms say, yeah, I just want some great quality time with my kids and my family. This year, moms, since they're spending so much time locked in the house with their kids, you know what they want? Freedom. They want time alone. And then in briefly in some of my conversations and mostly according to some online surveys and articles, I looked at what moms of teenagers and adult children were looking for in their relationship. And I'll do the same thing, top five. Things that moms of teenagers and adult kids were looking for. Number five, to be valued and appreciated. Number four, to be noticed and remembered. Number three, for you to take time to talk to me and share your life with me. Number two, time with you. Number one, I long to be loved by you. So one mom of three 20-somethings captured it well when she wrote, I want you. I want you to keep coming around when you're adults. I want you to ask me questions. I want you to ask my advice. Tell me your problems, ask for my opinion, ask for my help. I want you to continue sharing your life with me. Come over and laugh with me or laugh at me. I don't even care. Hearing your laugh is music to me. Call me, please, anytime. So as a mom of two 20-something-year-olds myself, I get that. You know, I love it when my kids call me and ask for my advice. Or when they call and they say that they're struggling with something and they just kind of want to talk through it. Or when they have great news to share, or they just have some funny, silly story to tell me. Or they have some funny family remembrance of some wild thing we did with them when they were kids. Or they send me goofy pictures of their muddy dog jumping on a clean couch. Or they send me a picture of some new recipe that they're cooking for dinner that night. My kids just make me smile and laugh. They can bring joy to my heart. I'm just proud of the caring and generous people they've become. And they can always make me keep seeing the world in new and fresh and creative ways. And my life wouldn't be as rich as it is, for me at least, without them in it. But the way that this article was articulated in some of the online surveys was that what we moms really wanted from our adult kids was to be valued and appreciated by you, was to be noticed and remembered by you, and to have your time, attention, and love. I looked at that list and thought, really? I don't think so. So kids, my kids, if you're listening, that is not what I hope and pray for in our relationship. Nor is it what the moms I spoke with this week really want most with their children. What the majority of the moms spoke about and were trying to cultivate was a sense of resilience within their children. So what their children in times of stress and strain, like we are in now, when their lives and routines are uprooted, would have the capacities to confront the crisis, seek help, gather resources, establish healthy practices, and become encouragers and maybe instruments of hope and change even for other people. So one mom this week said it this way: moms aren't looking for acknowledgement. The greatest gift would be to see our children's lives where they are thriving, where they feel loved and valued themselves, and find a way to offer that in relationships and community. And they have the energy and skill set and heart and commitment to put that into practice. Intangible acts of the kind of compassion that Jesus modeled for us. So moms, that's what you say you're looking for and hope you have established in your children's lives. So now, are you ready for a little good news? Let me share the top five things that children have said they appreciate about their relationship with their mothers. Let me read the top five things that children say they appreciate about their relationship with their mothers. Number five, that you taught and encouraged my faith. Number four, that you listened to me. Number three, that you modeled for me compassion and serving others. Number two, that you showed me unconditional love. And number one, that you encouraged me to be stronger than I ever knew I was. There's that resilience again. What was interesting is that every other year, unconditional love was the number one answer of what children most appreciated about their relationship with their moms. I think that this resilience is coming up this year, both from children's and moms, because with the added stress of the worldwide COVID pandemic, we're recognizing and appreciating the need for helping one another and tapping into the resources we need to be stronger and healthier together. Here's the way one person in their 20s said it. What's most impactful right now is not just that I'm loved unconditionally by my mom, but that she loves me and she taught me that I had it within me to be stronger than I knew when I'm surrounded by my faith, when I let God into my life, and when I surrender my ego and my need for perfection and can receive care from others. And then when I can be inspired by others, the action and creativity of others who want to get out and serve and make a difference in the world, and that I have something to contribute and offer as well. That's what kids are looking for you, from you this year in particular, Mom. Not just to know that they're loved unconditionally, but to be encouraged to be stronger than they ever knew they were. So where does that come from? Well, as the minister, of course, let me suggest that it comes at least in part from relationships and faith within the church. I asked my son Nathan to read the scripture lesson this morning, and if you listened carefully, you will hear in code a shout out to all you moms and women who have been and continue to be a source of encouragement and inspiration. I know he still reaches out to you, some of you, and some of the moms in the previous churches we were a part of, when he is looking for a little wisdom in life or career insight, or to talk through what's happening in a relationship, or he's excited to share about a new spiritual practice or an outreach opportunity. Because you have been those people who have embodied unconditional love, or have exhibited honest, down-to-earth faith, or you've always called out the best in him and spurred his curiosity and creativity for good in the world. And there's really no greater gift as a mom than to know that your son has other moms, other adults, other people of faith that he trusts and can count on and call upon and can turn to for support and relationship. And here's the thing. My son always comes away from those conversations more energized to recognize and use his own ideas and energy and to find something positive to do to make a difference in the world today. So thanks to all of you. So about that scripture that Nathan read from John's Gospel. Here's Jesus on the very end of his life. He's on the cross. His mother is standing nearby and his closest friend. And Jesus' final act on the cross is to entrust two people into the care of one another. It's Jesus' way of extending care and community and connection among people. Jesus lifts his head from his chest and he sees his best friend and his mother there. And he says to his mom, "Here is your son." And then he says to his friend, "Here is your mother." Now, some of the Bible commentaries want to say, oh, this is the establishment of the church and this is the creation of the church. And while that's an interesting thought, that's not really struck me this week. What struck me was something much more simple. That when the day was the darkest, Matthew, Mark, and Luke, when they comment at this point in the story, they say darkness came over all the land. When the day was the darkest and the forces of the world and the politics and religion were all opposed to Jesus, his concern was to bring people together. Just two people to start with, to give one a son and one a mother. When the day was the darkest and Jesus' own life hung in the balance, his thoughts were not for himself, but for his mother who would be grief-stricken and for his friend who would be lonesome. Is the day dark in your world right now? Are there events unfolding in the world or in your world where there are few signs of light? And the days were dark when Jesus hung on the cross. The forces of humankind were aligned against him. And Jesus knew it. He knew there was no turning back. And so here he is. What would his sermon be? What would those final words be? What could he say that would speak with the appropriate gravity, with the potential for change? What could Jesus say here that might change the world? Into that darkness, Jesus said a very simple thing. He looks at these two people and he says, "Here, I entrust you two into one another's care." A simple word of love. A routine word of care and concern for those close to him. And at first glance, it almost seems so inappropriate, ineffective in the face of all that darkness that's happening. But I think it's a huge gift to us that in the hours of darkness or complexity, Jesus calls us to the simplicity of love and relationship. world events, the things the media highlights as important are not the only things that matter. So do the simple acts of love, so do the words of love, the creation of community, and the bringing together of people and resources. Sometimes they may feel like they're really small in the face of darkness and anxiety, but they're sometimes so very important. So as we pray and read and listen to the crisis in our world today, what's the simple word of love or act of Christ that you could do to speak out in love? What's that word that you could speak that could create or strengthen community or affirm the people in your life or draw someone in or encourage or strengthen someone to be stronger than they knew they ever could be? I think Jesus realized that sometimes we're so easily paralyzed by darkness in the world. And maybe that's why some of his final words from the cross are so simple. I entrust the two of you to care for one another. And these two people now are encouraged out of that sorrow, out of that loss, in the midst of that darkness, to do a new thing, to love and care for one another in a new way. And here on that cross, Jesus redefines human relationships, and he creates this new understanding of family. It's a family not made by blood, but by love and care for anyone at loss or in need. And that's an important message for us to remember, especially this Mother's Day when the world is in crisis and people are suffering right here in our own community. What I appreciate about our church community is that we do have this expansive view of just what that means. We do see that our mission and our calling and our understanding of family is to equip and support and encourage anyone who needs to become stronger than they actually feel. It's why we have our prayer ministry and some of our smaller groups. It's why we invest in our community partners and talk about them so much to the point where they feel like family to us. And I just want to close by sharing with you one story about why this is so important. So every morning I get out lately, and I've been running about 8 a.m. at the lacrosse fields by my house. And so for the past several weeks, every morning, I've noticed this young girl with her lacrosse stick and her soccer ball there at the field by herself. And at first I didn't take much notice of it. I thought, well, maybe she's just practicing so safe social distancing, and maybe she just needs to get out of her house and get some exercise. But this week, on Friday, I got up really early and the sun is about 5:45. The sun was barely coming up. And there she was again, up that early at the field by herself with her soccer ball and her lacrosse stick. And I thought, well, this isn't quite right. And I'd actually gone over early to take some pictures of those signs put up around the sports fields around town by Connect, one of our community partners that deals with mental health and awareness. And I lingered there for a moment to see if she might engage with me. And sure enough, I had my dog with me, and she came over and started petting the dog and asking what I was doing there. And so I showed her these signs put up around town by Connect, these ones here, that say, "It's okay to not be okay. You matter. And 1 in 5 Utahns live with a mental illness." And it gave me a chance to say, I was from a church, and I said, you know, that we support Connect, and Connect's this group that just wants to make sure people know, and that young people like her know, that it's okay to make sure that that there's help out there if they're not okay. And it gave me a chance to ask her, you know, are you okay? And I could tell by the tears welling up in her eyes and those uncontrolled sobs, you know, when you can't catch your breath, to see that she was not okay. And it gave me a chance to look at her and say, as I pointed at the sign that says "You Matter," and to say, "Look, you matter. You really matter. And there are people here to help you." Now at 6 a.m., unfortunately, it was just me and my dog that were there to help her, to tell her that she mattered. And I didn't have my cell phone with me. All I had was my silly little Apple watch, my little Dick Tracy watch. So it was hard to make real cell phone calls. But I was able to call you, some of you. And so I rallied some troops. And before the sun had risen all the way into the sky, you, a lot of you, connected this family with where they needed to be to get them the life-saving resources and the help they desperately needed. It was a very complex situation. There were a lot of moving pieces. But the people I called, you rallied more help, you rallied more resources, and you were determined to get this family and this girl and these people the help they needed. And I just want to say that because of this church's commitment to connect, because of this church's commitment to our various community outreach partners, and all of your support of that, this girl, her sister, and her mother are spending Mother's Day somewhere safe, getting the medical care and being a part of treatment programs and support programs they need. And I just want to end by saying, thanks for being part of a church family that keeps looking for ways to show compassion for the people that Jesus entrusts to our care. I don't know about you, but I already feel blessed this Mother's Day weekend, knowing that Christ's love is working in each and every encounter and relationship that God brings my way. And I just pray that your day and your relationships bring you blessings as well. Happy Mother's Day. Amen.
Brother.